Donnie and Dolly. The team is supported by AbleAuctions.ca. Closing your business? We can help.
All of our guests today on this Monday, including Brian Burke, standing by, sponsored by Passant Motors. Due to popular demand, Passant Motors has continued on with their anniversary sale. Get huge discounts and great promotions with your next vehicle. Get all the details at PassantMotors.com. Brian Burke is going to join us now, a former NHL executive, former Canucks GM, Sportsnet analyst, and now executive director of the Professional Women's Hockey League Players Association, the PWHL. We'll start play in January 2024. Also, we wanted to get Brian on because he's recently voiced his disappointment in the NHL's decision to ban on-ice support of community causes, including the banning of Pride tape. And Brian joins us now. Brian, long time no hear from. How are you, sir? Thanks for doing this.
Good, Donnie. Thanks for asking me to join you.
Yeah, no problem at all. Brian, it might be obvious, but why is it important to you to come out so strong on this matter, the banning of Pride tape, among other things?
Well, for people who don't know my past, Donnie, obviously I had a son, Brendan, who was gay and was killed in a car accident. Mm. And my family has founded the You Can Play Project in support of LGBTQ plus athletes, to provide a safe and welcoming environment for them. So we're very active on this front and find the Pride tape. So the league first ruled Pride sweaters could no longer be worn. And I don't accept that. I don't understand it, but I get it. I understand that some players said, I don't want to wear this uniform. I don't want to wear this sweater. I get it, even though I don't agree with it. I don't think that's what the Pride sweater says. But Pride tape, the banning of Pride tape to me makes no sense.
Usually, Brian, whenever somebody asks a question when it involves pro sports or any business, the answer is something to do with money. So when it comes to the banning of Pride tape, what exactly is the NHL thinking here?
Well, I don't really understand it. To me, it's a fight they didn't need and didn't need to pick. I don't understand it. So the reason our response has been strong but muted. If you know, Donnie, I'm big on tough words. I'm big on words like ignorant, not, you know, arrogant, and I'm pretty direct. And if you look at our response, it was drafted in a way to say, let's figure out what's going on here, because Gary Bettman and the NHL have been wonderful supporters of LGBTQ plus causes. They've been phenomenal. And that's part of the reason everyone's saying, this is wrong, but not screaming and yelling just yet, because we're hoping there's some intermediate step. I think something else is going to happen here.
Yeah. And it's not just about the Pride tape. It's the supportive community groups as well. That seems to be going away. What do you think that means to the customer out there in the past when they have supported this sort of thing?
Well, I think, you know, I just saw a poll 2 or 3 days ago. I just saw a poll on CNN, I think it was, that said the majority of Americans favor protection of LGBTQ plus rights. Mm-hmm. So the majority of Americans have finally, for a minority, have finally said this is important. I think the world at large and the greater community has recognized this as a fact for years, but that's fine. Fact of the matter is the majority of Americans favor some favorable treatment and some protection for LGBTQ plus causes. So to me, this is something our fans want. Our audience certainly supports this. And the Pride days, Pride weeks, and Pride games have been met with great enthusiasm and great support. So I think, you know, Military Appreciation Night, Hockey Fights Cancer Night, sorry, there's a cart rattling through here.
Yeah, no problem.
There are causes that people love and genuinely support in the NHL community, including Pride. So to me, these are wonderful things. I think it's a shame they were taken away. But again, I understand at some level that here's the part that bothers me. Mm-hmm. Part that bothers me is no one called up and said, we got to get rid of those Military Appreciation Nights.
Yeah.
The only way we can do that effectively is to get rid of all of them. Someone went to them and said, we got to get rid of these Pride Nights. How do we do that? We can't do it any other way, so let's get rid of all of them. There's a big difference. So to me, I can live with what's going on. I don't get it. I don't agree with it. But the Pride tape to me is one step further, which is saying, no one's asking you to wear a Pride sweater. If you want to put the tape on, put the tape on. I don't get that ban.
Brian, you are the executive director of the Professional Women's Hockey League, the Players Association. The draft was held in September, and you called the draft the biggest day in the history of women's hockey. What's got you so excited about women's hockey right now, Brian?
Well, I think people should realize my background with the women's game. Like, it's not, I don't have a union background. I'm a lawyer, but I don't have a union background. I've been involved in the NHL for 35 years. I never thought I'd get this opportunity to work with the women. I have been a supporter and a fan of women's hockey for 25 years since Nagano. I've known all the star players. I've admired them from afar. I'm friends with them. I've supported them. So when they asked me to take this job, I actually burst into tears. I was so excited. So I never thought, 35 years working for teams and loving every minute of it, but I never dreamed I'd get a chance to work with the women. And I think it's the most exciting time ever for women's hockey, where we finally have one league and great support, the structure is there for this league to succeed. We've got to make sure that it succeeds.
Brian, the NHLPA's got a new boss, Marty Walsh. How do you think he handled the Mike Babcock situation? He flew to Columbus right away to meet with all the parties.
Well, I've met Marty Walsh. I don't know Marty well, but I really like what I know of him. I met him. I was friends with Travis Roy, who passed away recently. And when Travis Roy had his accident when he played at BU, Gary Bettman and I were two of the first people to visit him in the hospital. And I helped Travis. My old law firm set up a lot of the legal work for the Travis Roy Foundation. So I first met Marty Walsh when we had a 20-year reunion of Travis's accident. They asked me to speak and introduce Travis, and Marty came over and said hello, and that's where I talked to him. And this is a guy who's mayor of Boston at the time, and he ended up becoming a federal cabinet minister or labor secretary or whatever, like a senior-level job in the U.S. government. And he's a very engaging guy, very smart guy, very interesting guy, but a union background. And so for him to get this job, I've talked with him a number of times since. I think the world of him, I think he'll do a great job. I think the jumping in hard on the Babcock thing, I think was definitely a factor in the decision to make a radical move there.
Brian, you've been an agent before. The Canucks gave Garland's agent permission to talk to teams. What can an agent do in that situation, Brian, to help facilitate a trade? Or does it make a difference in your eyes?
Well, I think it can only help. If you've got influence, there are some guys in this business that have a lot of influence. And they can say, you know, I'd like to get this Garland kid moved. And you'd talk to the Canucks and say, can you eat part of the contract? You know, what are the terms I can talk under? So I think the agent can be a tremendous help in that situation. And maybe, especially where there might be hard feelings with the player involved or with certain teams, sometimes the agent can grease that over. So I think it's a smart move. I routinely did it with agents I trusted. I'd give them permission, tell them, here's the terms we trade the player under. If you can help them, great. At the end of the day, they have to find a dance partner that fits. This looks to me, he's a pretty good player. This looks to me like a cost issue more than anything.
Yeah.
Trading him with his cap number looks like the problem, not trading the player.
Yeah.
All right, Brian, you were recently a member of the Pittsburgh Penguins organization. I think we've gone down this road before with you before, but I'll do it again. Other people who used to be in the Pittsburgh organization, a guy by the name of Jim Rutherford, and there's Patrick Alvin, Rick Tocchet, now all in Vancouver. Brian, are the Canucks in good hands?
I think so. Jimmy Rutherford won two cups, three cups, right? He's got three now, Carolina and two in Pittsburgh.
Yep.
He's a quality guy. He doesn't have it. You can be in this business for as long as I am. I think Jimmy Rutherford has more friends than just about anyone. He's very popular, very well-liked, very well-respected. Hockey Hall of Fame. I mean, he's legit. Patrick Alvin worked with me in Pittsburgh. He's a terrific guy. I don't generally like Swedes, but I like Patrick, and he's a terrific guy. And Rick Tocchet's a top coach, so yeah, I think they're in great hands, not good hands, great hands.
Yeah. Hey, listen, I know you were joking when it comes to Swedes. You drafted a couple of Swedes who worked out pretty well. What do you think it means to the Canucks, Brian, to have Henrik and Daniel involved in the organization again?
Well, I think it was really smart. I think there's a risk that you do something like that for the PR value of it. Oh, the Twins, they're back involved with the Canucks. I think people would assume there's some PR value to it, which there is. But the fact of the matter is, these are two of the smartest people I ever had as players. I admired them greatly as players. I think the world of them still to this day. And they weren't just great hockey players. They're great people. So for them to come on board, I think they have a lot to offer in terms of being able to teach, being able to offer their opinions, be able to evaluate players. I think it adds a lot to the brain power of the organization and the class of the community. So they're wonderful people. Everything you read about the Twins is positive, but when you meet them in real life, it's even more.
Brian, thanks for this. We'll get you back on the show again pretty soon. Thanks so much.
Thanks, guys.